and all honored guests present today. When I was invited here, I was tossing and turning because I wasn't sure whether this is supposed to be a workshop where we tease into the detail of what this risk management is about, or in fact it was set out as a keynote address. Now I wasn't sure that something had started in the morning or early afternoon which dealt with the context of risk management and so on, and then all of a sudden when we're done, we're now talking about a keynote address. So I thought I'll try and combine the speaking to the detail as well as use some of the slide presentation as I go through some of the issues. Let me also say that my CV includes the University of South Africa because I studied some of the things I'm going to talk about here. So I'm bringing back some of these insights to the people who taught me when I was grappling with the issues of risk management. To the point where when I look at the work that we do at the audit office, I often characterize it as an effort to sound caution on a slippery road so that there is no need to cry fire in a crowded theater. And this was also expressed very eloquently when I listened to a story of a driver in Nairobi, Kenya, a taxi driver. And apparently there's a huge level of competition for clients along the road in Nairobi. So this taxi driver was coming down the road, and here was one driver overtaking him to get first at the bus stop where the customers were waiting for the taxi to take them wherever. So as this taxi driver came, he really ran very fast. And as he turned, stopping at the unmarked bus stop, the door, if you look at all the combis that we use here as taxis, as he turned, the door fell out. You know, those doors of the taxis that run in our townships. So as he swung out of the robot into the other road, the door fell and it nearly hit one of the passengers who were standing at the bus stop. And this Nairobi driver came out of the driving seat, went around where the customers were standing waiting and said, now the door is down on the floor. So he picked up his door, put it back into the hinges while they were watching, and said to them, hey man, the frightening possibility nearly became a horrendous reality. And on they came into the taxi and nothing happened afterwards. So that was his interpretation of risk management. So as I'm going to talk to some of these issues, I think I want to keep at the back of our minds that the stuff I'm going to talk about is always a frightening possibility that might result in a horrendous reality. Let me start with this. If I look at what we do in the audit office, we say that our role as an audit institution is to help strengthen the instruments of our democracy as a country by doing three things: enabling oversight, accountability, and governance in the public sector through the instrument of auditing in order to build public confidence. I'm sure there must be something that happened to this presentation I'm supposed to deal with here, and I've got something else. Oh, there you go. You got it. Is it this one? I'm going to start here when I speak about the issue of risk management, and assuming that earlier in the day we have looked at an element or more of what makes up this risk theory and this risk management. One of which is the issue of chasing all the traditional things that could go wrong, emphasizing the issue of internal controls as one of the key things that puts preventative measures in the area of risk management. However, in line with the topic that has been selected today, there's another area as well that we never look at. While we are searching for risks everywhere in the environment, we also need to start looking at what sort of opportunities are there in the environment for us to have a complete picture in terms of improving the results for the stakeholders that we are managing these resources for. In our case, when we look at the work that we do in the public sector, we always say that ultimately, when everything is said and done, there must be a benefit that flows to the citizens, because the appropriation of these resources, whether they might go to waste or whether certain opportunities will be missed, it's all about, so what do I get? And I think in the area of opportunity management, for me, the issue I want to underline is that I think we should start moving away from relying on chance and start to be decisive about the things that will chase success. And I think it applies with our institutions in higher learning, it applies with government agencies and any other institutions, because in the process of managing this uncertainty, where we do not know when the frightening possibility is going to turn into a horrendous reality, we still have to deal with the issue of maximizing value. So there's a competing priority in terms of extracting value while ensuring that you manage the uncertainty that could result in undesirable outcomes. Now, if I speak about the work that we do in the office, many of us will be familiar with the concept of a clean audit. Let me just say upfront that when we pronounce on our audit work and we say certain institutions are clean, we do not say they are free from abuse, nor do we say they are free from all those things that could divert their resources. We are focusing on three key elements that we believe make for an institution that is able to bounce back even if it's under attack. The first one is the area of financial management. And I see that in the G20 session that took place this past week, the International Federation of Accountants, when it sent a note to the G20, highlighted the need for the leadership of the G20 to start looking at issues of better public financial management as a strategic consideration. And I'm sure in the past they have not been looking at matters like these, because I think the likes of IFAC have also realized that if you don't pay attention to the area of public finance management as the G20, you're probably gonna lose a lot of opportunities, and there will be all sorts of things of the nature of illicit financial flows and many other such risks that could attach to the economies of the world. The other two areas that they covered in their input to the G20 was the issue of reporting. Reporting in the sense that it's no longer reporting about the activities that happened in the past, but it's looking at the reporting in an integrated fashion. And I'm gonna come to a slide now to demonstrate why this issue of integrated reporting also becomes critical in the journey of those people who are reporting on risks. And lastly, the governance arrangements in an institution. And I think we've already spoken about the need for council to do what it has to do, as well as for the executive team in the institution to focus on what it knows best. But what differentiates us in the public sector, as we report in the area of public financial management, we also pay attention to the issues of performance. Because public institutions, before monies are appropriated to them, somebody must go to Parliament and set out a policy that articulates an objective that has to be achieved, which must ultimately translate into benefits that will be enjoyed by citizens. So we're often interested in our evaluation of audit work as to, now that we are happy with how you've dealt with the money in terms of managing the debits and the credits and reporting on it, we are interested to know, what did you do? You were given this money to buy A, did you, or did you buy less than that? And I'm sure people in the room here will know that if in the public sector we were only auditing and focusing on the area of financial management, it will be easy for everybody. Because during the year, you don't have to have a full-time accountant in order to pass the audit all the time.
the auditors will pick up the stuff you've done wrong and they will say to you, can you please correct this and put it in the right place? Once you've done that without resistance, you end up with an unqualified audit opinion as far as your financial management discipline is concerned. But if in the process of doing the things that you did, you went and did your own thing, instead of buying bricks to build houses, you delivered these bricks to your place because you changed the address from the delivery truck, not to bring them to the site, but to take them to your place. So when we say, can we see the evidence of the performance on the back of these monies that we have audited by the financial statements, most of the time we don't find that. And that's where the critical issue is, when one evaluates whether an entity is clean or not. Then the third component, obviously, is one, you must respect the laws that are in place, especially when it comes to issues of financial management. Because every single one of those appropriations, whether it is the human settlements, whether it is environmental management, education, health, there is a law that applies in terms of how that money ought to be spent. If you go and procure goods and services, you can't just go procure them from somebody just because you are familiar with each other. You've got to do it in a process that is transparent, that creates a possibility as articulated in section 217 of the Constitution when it deals with issues of supply chain management. You can't just say, well, I'm used to getting this product from A, I will continue to do it with A. Because there lies a possibility for the diversion of these resources, because if you didn't apply yourself to a competitive environment, you might be paying a glass that has been hired for a function overnight at 250 a glass, because there was no competitive process to evaluate the best place you can get in order to procure those goods and services economically. So for us, if we speak about the issue of clean audits, we often confront the question, what is this thing about clean audits? It's not in the standards. Well, we say that good things that must be done do not have to be in the standards all the time. It makes sense that when people are entrusted with public resources, that the level of accountability must go beyond the finances. It must also deal with the tangibles. So that if we want to know whether education has been delivered, we will examine the area of performance management and performance reporting. Because if one looks at the issue of delivery of education again, it's not just the results that we all talk about in January for matric. It's about whether the learner transport systems that are supposed to be assisting people to get to school, are they operating? Are those finances not being diverted by flooding the system with a number of consultants who ultimately never get the kids to school because the cars break down along the way? It's about the learner material that needs to be delivered on a regular basis in order for the school term to start without having to worry about suppliers who are taking shortcuts and doubling their prices. It's about the teacher development programs, which are also entrusted with other institutions that deliver these particular programs. And if those programs are not reported accurately and the auditors cannot attest to them, you will end up with an unqualified with other findings opinion. That is the essence of what our clean audit, and in lies the issue of risk in terms of what could potentially go wrong if there is no adequate reporting on performance of an institution. So this area of performance management is about attesting to the validity, the accuracy, and the completeness of that information. It is not performance auditing in the sense that we do not test the economy, the effectiveness, and the efficiency with which the final outputs were delivered, because that's a separate exercise where you look at the detail of the delivery mechanism. Here we're looking at, can we trust this information? Because this information is going to go to planning documents in the future where it gets used to determine plans for the future, to make pronouncements about achievement of certain objectives. And if this information is not adequately tested through a statutory audit process, we could end up with misleading information that ends up saying we have achieved our objectives in healthcare when all that was being reported was not credible information. So the evidence for a lot of these, as I said, is largely sitting in the area of internal controls. If there are solid financial management disciplines, as well as informed strategic planning, we are likely to
move a lot closer to the achievement of a lot of these objectives that have been articulated. We know in our case we've got a national development plan that sets out all of the priorities with regards to education, with regards to health, with regards to infrastructure delivery, and all of these are linked to the expectations and the desires of citizens as we know it. But beyond us, there are also certain other contributions that we expected to make in the broader context of the continent as it is articulated in the AU Vision 2063. But globally, we also have a lot to contribute towards these sustainable development goals. Hence the issue about the importance of accurate reporting, especially on issues of performance, because when we look at the sustainable development goals ultimately, all 17 of them which were engaged and articulated at the UN, this is pretty much the business of every single government if one looks at it. There's no government that is insulated from any one of these objectives. Just this past couple of days, as we were completing our audit analysis with our teams, we started entering into conversations with our audit teams to say to them, we know you have reached conclusions on our audits with regards to whether they are qualified or unqualified, whether they are clean or not. That's the language that we normally use in the public domain. But let's stand back from all that you have examined from an audit and assess these goals in the context of the departments, the entities, the state-owned entities as well that are included in the public sector delivery mechanism. To what extent, when you look at education, and we packaged it by saying basic education, higher education, the National Skills Fund, sector education and training authorities, TVETs, and other training colleges. All of those, including the funds that come with them, have got a lot to do with the supply and demand that takes place within the area of developing skills and advancing education in the country. Without looking specifically at any one of them, what is common among them in terms of not realizing the benefits of that value chain? Because if you look at CETAs will go out and engage the services of external service providers on issues of project management. And they go through a project management course to death for 2 weeks, and they come back, and then they ask what is the next thing that we must do. 30 million rand budget of a particular CETA is finished in one financial year, but there's no real evidence of any contribution that has been made towards the development of whatever the mandate of that CETA was. It could be in the construction sector, it could be in the general services sector. However, the Skills Fund, which is also another fund that has been established as well as the CETAs, which are largely about providing a capacity for people to get skills so that when all these other goals in terms of the sustainable development goals are realized, there are people who will go into number 9, for example, because there's industry, innovation, and infrastructure. There are people who are able to test assumptions about all manner of things because they have been trained and they have gone through a skills development process. If we look at issues of the water delivery, we've also done an analysis in this area where we said we've been doing audits, statutory financial audits, on the water department in terms of water and sanitation. Water boards are part of the delivery mechanism. The water department itself, and a flood of a lot of high-tech service providers in the form of engineers who are responsible for laying the infrastructure. And when we did this examination on the performance audit, again, taking the view that the value chain is the approach that we will apply to this. Obviously, water comes from the rivers and the dams. They go through a process and chlorination process and all sorts until the water gets transferred to a reservoir. But if between a municipality and one of the service providers there is no clear set of deliverables that need to be sent out, you might find that 18 million rands in a particular part of a province has been spent laying the infrastructure, but there's no water that is coming out of the tap. Then you discover that, in actual fact, the reason that there is no water is because the budget for the reticulation from the reservoir to the taps has run out. So somebody must wait for the next cycle of the medium-term expenditure framework if they are gonna be lucky in a depressed fiscal environment. So that's the kind of stuff that we are looking at here, where there's significant levels of wastage, when you look deeper into these areas. So it's not so much about the procedures in isolation, but it's the absence of these disciplines of risk management that end up threatening the natural delivery in terms of many of these areas. And it was interesting looking at this with the audit teams, where we don't talk about debit and credit. We don't talk about the definition of a liability. We talk about, when you look at that particular audit, as well as the goals and the objectives that are set out in the estimates of national expenditure document, which articulates exactly what each of these sectors is supposed to deliver over a period of time, what do you see? Well, we see the debits and the credits going out of the books, but when we ask for the evidence to report on what has been achieved, far less than what was committed always comes back. That's the issue, I think, that we need to look at, to say, in the light of this deep risk in this environment, there are many opportunities that are lost to change the lives of the citizens. Hence, we look at these sustainable development goals as one of the mirrors that we will use to assess on an ongoing basis where healthcare resources go. Another example, again, in terms of the area of healthcare, we did a performance audit, which we are yet to complete, which looks at the value chain and the delivery of pharmaceuticals across the country. It's another area that has got difficulty. While we are looking at that, we pick up that in one place in Xhosa, in the Eastern Cape, they reported that there was this gentleman who returned to the village having been injured in the urban areas. And because there are no ambulances in that part of the world, budgets in the province of the Eastern Cape had been made available, pronounced on, and agreed in the legislature. But there are no ambulances there. Some of the people who have to wake up and go and fetch medicines from the nearby clinic have got to leave their homes at 4 in the morning, while kids are also expected to wake up and go to school afterwards. And what you have is a situation, because these risks about the use of these finances are not being taken care of, they immediately translate into people dying because those healthcare facilities are not coming forth. Others not performing well in education because nobody was taking care of their needs for them to survive a day at school. And I think there's an interconnection between how taking off the eye off the risk issue and the impact that it is having on the general progress with regards to some of these that we also have committed to. Bringing the issue back to, once again, if I take the spotlight on the area of the PFMA audits, which are largely the departments and the provinces that we're reporting on every year. Over the last 4 or 5 years, we've started to see an upward trend with regards to the issue of clean audits in this instance, taking into account all those three elements. It is a picture that is largely driven by many people waking up at leadership level who in the past ignored the audit outcomes and thought this was a matter for accountants to worry about. And we actually got them to wake up and say, this is not a matter for accountants. Accountants may be the front line in terms of doing the work for debits and credits, but the people who are supposed to drive this are the ones who make these commitments. Because if those finances are protected, if that governance arrangements are in place, the chances are that we'll probably narrow the space to get closer to achieving these objectives. We've seen similar trends, although from a very small base. I'm sure if one looks at local government in terms of what we understand, the issues of accountability, financial management, and governance in local government, it is worse than in national and provincial departments, as you see in that trend. Slow steps in many other areas, and I'm sure you remember, it is not widespread in local government across many provinces. We've already pronounced on this prior to the second half of this year, where we drew attention to what is it that goes wrong in local government when it comes to issues of accountability. So we're still a long way to go as far as you are concerned as an office in strengthening the hand of risk management to ensure that we reap the benefit that sits with the delivery of some of the programs that are spent through these areas of government. If I just look at the PFMA in total is somewhere around 420-something institutions, being departments nationally, all the departments that you have in provinces. Each province has got an average of about 12 departments. All the entities that are set up which have now become 700 and something entities across the whole country, if you cast your mind back to the report on the Presidential Review Commission, where they are starting to ponder what to do with these entities that have been developing over time, because some of them may have been created for reasons other than what was written on paper. I'm not going to bore you with this, but this is just a planning cycle that takes place in government. If you had this and you thought this was working, you probably would have thought that everybody who sits under that bar that says institutions is being properly checked. Because when your year starts, you've got to tell the world what you plan to do over a period of time. And when the world agrees with that, you still have to come back and tell us what you've achieved in the last quarter in terms of your operations, your targets, the resource allocation, and the implementation of your programs. A lot of this happens, but nobody takes care to follow up on whatever it is that is either raised by auditors or whether it is raised by risk management. But at the heart of it, it's not a complicated planning cycle. It's a planning cycle with clearly determined outcomes and different cycles of intervention by different players, including risk management. And a lot of these opportunities fall flat, even if you subject the area of education as a sector to this, or health to this, you will find that a lot of the stuff that never reaches the ultimate beneficiary is because those that are charged with leadership in these institutions do not respond when matters are brought to their attention. The reporting on performance, we do report this as well in municipalities and everywhere else, as I said. So the area that is pink on this slide is an indication of the extent of entities that receive findings from the audit office with regards to inaccurate reporting on their performance. It's one thing to have this 100 billion rands to spend, but it's another to account for the things that you did with it. And what this slide shows is that the level of accountability, especially when one looks at municipalities, we've observed that over time it is starting to get better. If you look at the 55 in total that were given a clean pass about 5 years ago, and that has almost doubled 5 years later. However, we still have a large concentration of entities that are battling to translate the things that they do to what the money has been spent. Well, it's easy for people who are well informed and who are very smart to take the money and claim they're gonna do A and B. When you go and see what's on site, you find something else or nothing. But the money is gone, and that's why we are reticent to chase the debits and the credits in isolation, because that's easy. And the accountants did it very well when they developed the double entry system of accounting. They wanted to make sure that there's no confusion. There's two places where it can be. It can either be in a credit or a debit. And the fight that we often have is about which debit and which credit. So you're not in a murky world of trying to figure out what else sits between debits and credits. That was made very easy by accountants. And that's why when auditors come at the end of the year, if I was an accountant and I was only reported on the finances, I wouldn't worry. I just wouldn't do the books. I'd leave the books as they are, because the accountants will find the errors, point them to me, ask me to correct, and then I correct. If I'm disciplined enough to do what they say I must do, I'll end up with an unqualified report. But it gets hectic when they say, what happened to your internal controls when it comes to the reporting on performance as well as compliance with laws and regulations? Then you might find that if I was supposed to buy a tractor in a particular municipality in a rural province, and I decided that, no, I'm not gonna buy a tractor with this budget. I'm gonna buy a V6 because I'm a new municipal manager, I want to have wheels. The reality is that you can have the debits and the credits posted in the right account even if you bought the V6, right? If you are not gonna be tested on performance, that's fine. But here, if you said you bought a tractor and you ended up buying a V6, then we're gonna call for performance information for that tractor. That performance information could be the removal of waste and garbage, or it could be using it to assist the communities to plow their fields. So if you are gonna keep a record of it, you'll be able to find that performance information, but you are unlikely to have that information for a V6. And if therefore you are not able to perform to report on your performance, you're gonna lose a clean audit, and that's where the pressure is gonna come for those that are entrusted with public funds. where's the bulk of the issues when it comes to compliance, the third component? We didn't test everything because other things are not really relevant for purposes of the audit, but we thought these are the issues that are relevant for an audit. If you look at these, the much grayer one is the current period that we assess, where we look at issues of prevention of unauthorized, irregular, fruitless, and wasteful expenditure. So what has started happening now, these are the expenditures that are undesirable, even if you follow the names of them. I mean, unauthorized, it's like the person who has been given power for this expenditure was not involved in it or in its articulation. If you look at irregular expenditure, I mean, surely for even the academics in the room, that's not a normal English word, irregular. Already as you say it, you can actually figure out as you say it that there's something deeply wrong with that expenditure. In the sense that somebody takes shortcuts. It decides that, well, because I got a budget for a tractor, I'm not gonna go and advertise it in the Sunday Times because people are gonna see that I'm advertising for a V6 when they see the Sunday Times. So I'm gonna take shortcuts and I'm gonna go buy it from a dealership that I know. Now, we look at this and we say, can we see? We see you bought a V6, but how did you? No, but I bought it from Jan Potriter around the corner. Oh, okay. That's irregular expenditure. You've got to explain this, because when we say it's irregular, we are not saying that it's fraudulent or it's corruption at face value when we look at it. This is the instance where we are identifying areas of expenditure and you are saying to those that are charged with oversight, you better take an interest in what is behind the deviation from the prescribed rules that have been set by council in terms of procurement activity. We don't know yet, but we are sounding a caution on a slippery road before all of us cry fire in a crowded theater. And if you look at the quantum of this, we've quantified this in local government. I think came up at a number that's somewhere around 14 billion in total if you look across the system, where a lot of people basically do as they please with the procurement of goods and services without adhering to the systems and the disciplines of internal control. Now, there are two issues when there's a breakdown in internal control. It could be to do with human competence. Now, that human competence is a fertile ground for somebody who has got intentions to divert these resources, because that person who sits there in that finance department or in the procurement department doing this without following rules because they don't have the requisite competency are likely to be the person who's gonna take further instructions without question for the expenditure. Then you're dealing with a big issue now, because I can put in an invoice for 200 million rands and I can force it upon you to accept this invoice because you worried that if I leave this job and I get fired, I might have no other place to go work somewhere in Verulam or wherever in the country. Now, the critical issue that you are raising as far as the issue of compliance as well as the issue of preventing irregular expenditure is about dealing with the two devils in internal control, one being the competence of execution of the work, the other being deliberate intent to frustrate internal controls in order to achieve unintended objectives. And so the rest go then. I think the last point that I want to highlight here is that in the absence of consequences in an environment where there's a breakdown in internal controls, you are likely to have these lower standards being the new standards. Because if nobody's gonna do anything to me and I've got all these transactions and transgressions every year, I might as well carry on because nothing will happen even if I continue to spend 14.5 billion in a manner that is considered to be irregular. The management of contracts in procurement, if one thinks about just the value chain I was talking about with regards to the supply and delivery of water, there are many high-tech institutions that understand how to do that engineering activity. Again, internally in the institution, if we do not have supervisory systems to make sure that we ask the questions, even if you are not engineers, but we ask the engineer, how did you come to this 120 million estimate for the remainder of this project in terms of a contract, the chances are that you might be paying much more than you need to pay because you don't have the requisite levels of monitoring and oversight within the institution to prevent some abuse that may not be internal to in the institution, but it may be a collaboration of external suppliers who have caught on to the fact that you've got weak controls in your environment. And some of the observations that we look at as far as the reporting on performance information, we kind of deal with it in two places. One, either the information must be useful in the sense that you yourself understand that you are not reporting bricks when you said you are going to report houses. We don't want to know how many million bricks you bought. We want to know how many houses, because that's what your target was. And the appropriation of the budget was not based on the bricks that you are going to buy. And that's why we raise issues of usefulness. However, when it comes to the issue of reliability, we also test this for reliability and go through the system to say, how did you accumulate the number of 120 houses for that particular municipality? Is there a system that nobody can interfere with, whereby they can go into an electronic environment and change passwords and change parameters in the master file, and we end up with 120,000 houses when in fact there's nothing on the ground? Some projects that we've looked at in terms of the urban renewal, where the land was made available, monies were made available for a house to be built, all that there is the infrastructure for services infrastructure. But to this day, in one of those urban renewal projects that have triggered some serious fight at the time, I think not long ago, there's not a single house there physically. So the audit is able to look at this to say, well, we can see what you've got in the books and what you claim in your reports. Let's go see these houses. So we remember we've got the geo information and all the stuff to know which place was approved. We get there was no house. So some of the issues that we look at in terms of this are really sticky, because they actually point out to that which is expected to have been done with the money, but it's not just limited to the debit and the credit. Some of the things that we've picked up in the audit work that we've done is, as I said, the issue of consequence management, addressing the challenges in terms of delivery, as well as seeing the opportunity for certain things that are being paid for all the time, but that service doesn't really make sense because its time has passed. So there are many instances, because of lack of management of contracts, where continuous payments are being made to certain suppliers, but there's no real delivery of any of the stuff that the payment is meant to be for. Now, the key lines of defense, I guess, just as a brief comment on these, is that every one of the key elements of internal control as defined in the combined assurance model, in order for this system to work, they all have to kick in. Firstly, the people who are employed in managerial positions right up to accounting officers, including the CEOs of state-owned entities, they have capabilities in the sense that the budgets are spent to employ the senior management to do that which is expected. If there are serious weaknesses there, there's nothing the oversight will be able to do. Because for the systems of internal control and risk management to be robust, they need to be managed by people with the requisite technical competences to be able to identify and do that which needs to be done when things go wrong. It's not the role of oversight. Oversight, which is largely the next level of internal audit as an instrument of risk management, including the audit committee, as well as the coordinating departments like Treasury, like COCTA, and for example, in the public sector, the likes of the DPSA, because the DPSA is responsible transversally for the human resource element across the system, while National Treasury is responsible for the financial management discipline, and COCTA being responsible for the intergovernmental relations and arrangements. And so we call that the coordinating or the monitoring departments. They have an interest in the full effect, like National Treasury, of what happens to this 1.6 trillion that has been allocated in the past year. The DPSA and other related entities are responsible for and ensuring that the people who are employed in government have to possess the minimum requisite competences for them to deliver the many things that I've highlighted in the other slide. And largely, when they go to Parliament, it shouldn't just be a conversation about you are incompetent, you don't know what you are doing, and then you have headlines saying that the accounting officer has agreed that they are incompetent. That's not oversight. That's abusing the person who is there in the meeting who is not able to answer that question at that time. But the real essence of this is that when the deficiencies of yesteryears are not being dealt with, it is the task of these committees to know that you are creating an environment where these things are becoming systemic and deep in the environment if they are not addressed as they arise. Not to get people to feel awkward going to parliament because they are scared, they think they're going to be screamed at. So for me, I think there's a number of areas that need to be focused on to actually deal with the real essence of this thing. If all of them can have a conversation and say, we're going to test this with the portfolio committees, because the portfolio committees review the strategic plans that you've submitted. They are the ones who do the in-year monitoring to check whether you do indeed deliver the things that you said you will deliver. That's what that conversation is about. So that when the external auditors come to attest to the information that has been accumulated, it ought to be a confirmation to those that play that oversight. Otherwise, the risk management job they are doing is as good as fruitless and wasteful expenditure. And perhaps, I guess it starts here. Leading by example in these institutions, perhaps, it needs to be put at the top of the agenda. And I think it's not about what level of skill the person must possess, whether they are an accountant or a medical practitioner or a teacher, but all of them need to possess these type of qualities in order for us to have institutions that can be described as leading by example. And if one looks at, again, one of the sustainable development goals, among them, goal 16 speaks about peace, security, and strong institutions. These are some of the foundational elements that are required to at least have a better chance of promoting the strength of these institutions, whether it's higher education, whether it's the institutions in the public sector, or even the private sector entities that are involved sometimes in extractive industries where the regulator is a public institution. All of them have a responsibility to do this. Otherwise, what we are chasing, all of us, in terms of creating economic growth and creating revenue in order for us to pay up for the things that need to be paid, including those that are vulnerable in society, those will not arise as long as we've got these significant gaps where there is no attention being given to them. I'm not going to go through the detail of this. I will leave it for the slides in terms of what we see as some of the things that ought to be done by these different levels of oversight. As I said, these are the people who possess the technical training and the tools to do the job. If they can be encouraged right up to the level of the executive authorities to see to it that they take what is appropriate for them to do, because this massive animal called risk has got many opportunities that are not apparent in it. The only time that they are realized is when people are doing what they are meant to do. Spoken about these ones, internal and audit committee and the public accounts. And I guess if one looks at this in the context of higher education, we've seen all of these. Today we were debating this thing in our audit teams, looking very deeply at the issue of education and higher education. Guess what? One of the observations from the team members, and these are staff in the office who have been in these audits and we are engaging them to reflect on how the journey was. So they started reflecting on higher education, and guess what? The first point to come out was the 2 billion rands that was transferred from the National Skills Fund, and nobody knows now where they're gonna operate or get it because of the fees must fall. So already they are, as auditors, observing and picking up some of these issues. I'm sure these are the debates that are already taking place in higher education institutions. But our teams have made observations in this to say, well, that was what was had to be done then, but the question is, where is that plug gonna come in? Because the National Skills Fund no longer have what it used to have in terms of those reserves. They were depleted because there was excess resources there for whatever reason, because these objectives that were set for it were never carried out. Then it gets plugged into fixing that which was done as a temporary short-term measure. Now, these are some of the insights that we've seen, so that we actually say to our guys, you're not just seeing numbers, you're also seeing what is going on in terms of the entire activity in education. And I think there are many number of observations that we have made, and we normally produce an education sector report as part of the reports that we issue to inform the Education Council, and sometimes we issue a health report to inform the Health Council under the supervision of the Minister of Health. So these are some of the observations, I guess, which say that in the context of all of this, that is resources plowed into developing skills and education, we still have high rates of unemployment on the other side, which are part of what we dealing with when we speak about those triangular challenges. I'm not even going to speak to this. I think it's really a question of what is the link between all these things that are put into building skills and building capacity for people to grow their knowledge, as well as to bring that knowledge into research areas. But one interesting thing, when we looked at the science and technology environment, there were very good examples and very good insights that the teams shared. You know, they say that when you go to these councils like the National Research Foundation, the CSIR, the Department of Science and Technology, and all these related entities in the science and technology, you see an almost different culture. You've got people who've got very strong and deep technical skills in very many areas, but alongside them are well-trained accountants and CFOs who understand and interpret the business that is pursued by those science councils, and many of them have got clean audits because the disciplines are being observed, and the people, when they get engaged by the auditors, typically because they are high-level technical people with high levels of logic and understanding of things, they don't push them aside. They stand up and say, but this is what we're intending to do when we're planning this thing. Can we bring along our accountant to explain to you what journey we were on? That's what auditors are about, and that's what risk management is about. If there's somebody who is able to explain these technical issues and is able to address and deal with them, you end up with different results. And that's why many of them have said in the report that they are going to produce, they will elevate that sector as one of those that have got these disciplines in abundance. So it's not even a case of we must go to another part of the world to go find out what we must do. A lot of it is, yeah. So I asked the guys, well, they want me there to speak about opportunity generation through risk management. So what must I do from risk to opportunity? They say, well, look at the CETAs. This is now the feedback and the insights I get from our guys. They say, look at the CETAs. The CETAs are expected to facilitate research on skill demand and supply and so on and so forth, but they've got limited or no capacity to do this. Isn't this an opportunity for universities who have the competences to do the research to take on a challenge like that, for example, when we start looking at the realm of risk versus opportunity? Has those engagements within the sector of people who are responsible for production of knowledge have taken place to be able to relieve the resources from the institutions where this is not a capability and take them to where it is a capability so that there's a better chance that a university, when it engages with this, it will also help in providing the much needed work that they do every day. If you look at the public sector again, if one looks at the indicators that are there for assessing performance information, where you start looking at inputs, the activities, the outputs, the outcomes, and the impact. Who is best placed within our institutions of higher learning to provide the competences that will develop, that will provide the guidance for the development of these indicators, as well as to assess how effective some of these programs are implemented? Again, the opportunities do not have to be articulated in high tones, but it's about looking at the institutions that exist to say, what are the opportunities that fall by the wayside that other institutions within the sector, in this case universities, could take on, so that ultimately when we look at these, we look at what is the impact overall to the citizens. Are we, by doing this issue of looking at the research on the skills that are needed in society, are we doing this in order to articulate what is it that we are producing in education? Because we might be producing certificates for the greater part, but we have got no idea what sort of appropriate skills are needed. When those goals start getting closer to being realized or getting a chance to be realized, you start asking yourself, if I've got industry, I've got innovation and infrastructure, and I've got assets under the in the land as well as under the sea, where are the people who are going to take advantage of these opportunities when we have to do that which has been set out in our plans? And perhaps this is the area that needs to be interrogated, and I think it sits very closely to the area of higher education. I leave this. So I guess for us, the last point to make here is that perhaps there's a need for us to think differently about how we see the interplay between risk and opportunity, and perhaps find ways to make sure that in our respective institutions, when we talk about risk, We're not stressing about the fact that, you know, a frightening possibility might be a horrendous reality, but we're actually looking there for opportunity to do that which may cause us stress to become our bread and butter tomorrow. So if that will be the orientation for all of us, we probably will realize what is intended to be realized whenever we get announcements that we've got a 1.6 trillion rands to spend. Thank you very much.